What is up, Discovery Student Ministries? Happy Wednesday. This is the last Wednesday of the month.
Wow.
January
the last
is
Wednesday
over.
Of the series that we're doing.
And the last Wednesday of this series. And because it's the last Wednesday, I think we should do something exactly the same every time. Nathan, what time is it?
It's game time.
our game this week, Nathan, I picked this one just for you.
I am so excited to see what this
Chat is. ChatGPT or Bible Proverbs. So perfect. What's going to happen?
Wow. Wait, we're playing this together, though. Remember, guys. We're a team. We're a team this time. Yep. You have to beat us.
Yeah.
Oh, so that's exciting. A little bit easier.
So exciting. Okay. All right. So decide whether each proverb is from the Bible or it's generated by ChatGPT.
What? GTP?
That's a typoed.
Or it's a knockoff.
That's hilarious. It's the wish.com version.
Yes, it's the ChatGPT.
Okay, so just a reminder, what's going to happen, we'll see it on the screen. You guys will have like 10 or 15 seconds. There'll be a timer there for you. And then you need to, together as a team, come up with your answer. Decide whether it's Proverb or ChatGPT. And if you're right, give yourself a point. You're competing against the team of Nathan and myself.
Let's
you guys ready?
Go.
Let's go. All right, the first one. A tree grows strong with deep roots, and a mind grows wise with humble pursuits. What do you think?
I think it's ChatGPT.
Yeah. So real quick, do we want to say like proverb, like Bible and
so
chat?
So you get a visual cue?
So that there's a visual. I don't know.
Proverbs, ChatGPT. Yeah. It's always the thumbs down for the chat.
Yeah. We thought this one was ChatGPT. It is not scripture. Let's see if we're right.
Of course we're right. Of course. Good job. All right. How you guys doing? Let's see if you can beat
us. We got one already.
Beat the geeks.
A beautiful woman lacking discretion and modesty is like a fine gold ring in a pig's snout.
All right, discuss. All right, Matt, what do you think?
Yeah, this is a proverb. Let's find out if we're right. It is from Proverbs 11:22.
How many of you guys watching thought, oh, the Bible doesn't say that a woman looks good if the gold ring in a pig's snout? Those were a bunch of words, weren't they?
I don't know what you just said. Let's go to number three.
I was trying. All right, whatever. Oh, goodness.
Lies will get any man into trouble, but honesty is its own defense.
Oh.
Discuss. All right, Nathan, what is it?
We think it's GPT. I'm going to say, I don't think I was quite communicating properly my pig snout thing before. I'm very sorry. Just move on.
Speaking of moving on.
Oh,
we
no,
are wrong.
We're wrong. It's in Proverbs 12:13. It's the ChatGPT translation, though.
Oh, that's an interesting way to put it. man, that's interesting because we said this is true. But it feels like a computer wrote it.
Yeah.
Oh,
all right.
Here's what's awesomely awful right now is the Proverbs we're reading through in our Bible through the year plan.
Yeah.
The whole of Proverbs, every single month, we're getting all of Proverbs.
Right. So we should see this.
So if
did we read this recently?
Well, this was like, this was pretty
12. Yeah, because it's chapter 12. Yeah. That's why it felt so fresh.
So true, but computerized. My translation didn't word it this way. Next one. Adversity is the chisel that sculpts our character.
I love it.
All right. We think that this one is also ChatGPT. Now, we were wrong last time,
so I'm hoping we're right this time.
Yes.
Nice.
Yes.
All right.
I like the little computer robot guy. Yeah.
That is the embodiment of ChatGPT. True story.
Well, you didn't. Never mind. We'll move on. All right. Next one. Life's journey is not about avoiding the storms, but learning to dance in the rain.
All right. Discuss.
All right, Nathan.
All right. We think GBD. There's no rain dancing in the Bible. There you go. All right.
So we've only gotten one wrong so far. So
we're
if you guys are
pretty
perfect,
good.
You're still beating us. Remember, if you win next week, let us know right away. Next week, you'll get a shout out and an extra prize in your small groups. Even a stubborn fool is thought to be wise if he keeps silent.
Ooh.
Discuss.
All right, Matt, what do we think? What do we got here?
This speaks deeply to my heart because the only time anyone has ever called me wise is when I've kept my mouth shut. So I'm going, it's Bible.
Bible. Now, bonus points if you knew the actual, leaders.
Tricky,
if any of your students actually knew the proverb, they get a bonus point.
Yeah. 17. Proverbs 17:28 was this one. Here
17.
We go. Kindness is a seed that grows into a tree of compassion. Nope, shading those who seek its refuge.
We had one similar about a tree and kindness.
Discuss. All right, we're not confident in this one.
It's a little tricky, but we're going to go ChatGPT. Oh, good. Whew, that was a close one, guys.
Who dogged it?
I don't know if it was a close one.
All right, let's get our next one. A small spark can start a great fire, but it takes wisdom to keep it from burning out of control.
Oh.
Discuss. We're pretty confident. It's chat.
Yeah, there's nothing about wisdom to keep it from burning out of control. Now, it tricks you because James talks about a small spark starting a fire that makes your brain kind of go there, maybe.
Yeah. Yep. All right. The way of the good person is like the light of dawn. It grows brighter and brighter until it is full daylight.
Discuss.
All right, what do we think?
All right, we had a lot of discussion about this, but we're going ChatGPT. Oh, no. This is a weird translation then. Weird translation is the answer.
Four. Proverbs 4:18. You guys, we're going to have to do another game like this. Get someone to make it for us. Come December after we've read through Proverbs 12 times.
Yeah, at that point, maybe we'll do a little better. But again, I think these are weird translations.
All right. An open heart and a listening ear are the keys to understanding.
And understanding is the foundation of empathy.
That's exactly where my mind went also, Matt.
Discuss.
Oh my goodness.
All right, we are very much not confident. Potentially, we disagree a little on where we should go, but we were both just like, I don't know.
It's tough.
So because the last two we got wrong, we said it was computer when it was actually Bible.
Right.
I don't want to be wrong in that way again. And so because of that, we're saying Bible.
No! Now we can't tell the difference between the Bible and the robots, Matt. You have permanently soiled our reputation.
All right, we got one more little bonus question. We're not going to necessarily call it a tiebreaker. This is just an extra question where potentially...
Well, unless they're tied.
Right, if you're tied with us, it's legit. But if we both get it right, then it doesn't even matter. Don't waste your breath on fools, for they will despise the wisest advice. Discuss. right, Nathan. I think we've gotten three wrong.
Okay.
So we need to get this one right.
All right. We got to get this one. All right. We are going Bible. Hallelujah. Go. We're not totally idiotic.
Let us know if you beat us, not if you tied us. You have to beat us.
You have to beat
us. And we got three wrong, so it probably wasn't that hard to beat us this week.
My goodness.
Man, while we go cry in a hole for a couple seconds, we'll be right back.
We'll be right back, yep.
All right, we're back and we are wrapping up our series called Real Eyes through 1 John. And again, we've done this every week. Let's just get right into it. What is the point of this letter?
1 John 5:13, the whole point of this letter, John says, I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life.
Right, so John wants us to realize that they have eternal life, that we have eternal life, right?
I love it.
Something that needs to be constantly on our minds, and eternal life, we've talked about this, it begins immediately when you follow Jesus. It's not something we wait for until we die. So in the first week, we read that John said that some people are walking in the light, some are walking in the dark. There's this contrast there between the two. And 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us.
Right.
And purify us, cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Love it.
And then the second week, we looked at this idea of Jesus as our advocate.
Right.
Our defense attorney, paraclete. Our lawyer, our paraclete.
Not a bird.
Or not a pair of cleats.
Not a pair of cleats, but that's a good way to remember it.
Yeah, and so that was just a really cool way to be reminded of what Jesus does for us before the almighty, all-righteous judge in God. Then last week, John talked about how John talks about that we should love one another, right? And how we're not surprised that that's a command. Agape love.
Don't be a murderer like Cain.
Right.
But love people instead.
And do you remember how John kind of described what that agape love looks like for us?
Yeah, he said that when you lay down your life for a friend or pizza, you love them. If you were here in person last week, we talked about how you could take a bullet for a pizza. That means you love it.
Yeah, no. But that other part, we should lay down our lives for one another, being willing to sacrifice self, my wants, my needs, my desires for someone else, for the good of somebody else. So tonight, like I mentioned, we're going to finish this look at 1 John. And kind of it takes us back to maybe that courtroom from week two. So 1 John chapter 9, verses 5 to 12.
All right. 1 John 5, 9 through 12 says, if we receive the testimony of men, the testimony of God is greater. For this is the testimony of God that he has borne concerning his Son. Whoever believes in the Son of God has the testimony in himself. Whoever does not believe God has made him a liar because he has not believed in the testimony that God has borne concerning his Son. And this is the testimony that God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life.
So there's a word that was mentioned there a lot,
he
right?
He says the word testimony so many times.
Yeah, that's one of those typically like churchy words. When we hear testimony, we think of like this idea of the story of me first learning about Jesus.
So we are singing a song at church. While you're watching this, we sang a song at church on Sunday called My Testimony.
Yeah. Yep. Interesting. And we use that word often as it relates to how I came to know Jesus and learn about him. Right. But John doesn't necessarily mean it that way here. This isn't like that churchy word testimony. This is actually more the legal record of the court. Right. So that's why I said we're kind of going back into that courtroom. This is that moment in the movie when like the judge asks for the court record to be read aloud.
Right.
Right. That's the recorded testimony. And so in this case, in 1 John, this is the recorded testimony of God,
right?
John says that God's given us eternal life, and this life is in Jesus. So if you have Jesus, you have life.
Right.
And if you don't have Jesus, you don't have this life, right?
That God gave us eternal life. Yeah.
Yeah.
And it says, if you don't believe in God, has made him a liar because he has not believed in the testimony that God has borne. So it's like, if you're not believing, you, it's not like you're calling God a liar.
Right.
Because God is saying if that you just need to believe in him to have eternal life.
Right.
And so if you're going to not believe and to not have eternal life, it's like you're calling God a liar. It's interesting.
This is one of the passages of scripture that a lot of people take issue with because this is kind of the exclusivity of Christianity.
Interesting.
Right? And a lot of people have a problem with the only way to Christ or to God is through faith in Jesus.
Right.
People have issue with that, right? Like, we don't want there to just be one way. We want there to be many ways, many opportunities. Mm. And according to John and this testimony on court record, right? Only through Jesus can you find life.
Right.
That's exclusive. That frustrates people. And I actually really like having conversations with people who get frustrated by this fact, because at the end of the day, we have to admit that the Bible teaches there's one way.
Right.
And so if we say we believe the Bible, but we don't believe that,
right,
we don't actually believe the Bible, right?
That's true.
And the way I look at it is, if this is true, which I believe it is for good reason, then I'm so glad that someone was willing to share that truth with me when I was younger.
Yeah.
And I want to take the opportunities to share that truth with others because they need to know it. They need to know what the testimony is.
Right. If this is true, like you said, and we believe it is, and it's, you know, the idea of exclusivity, truth is generally exclusive,
right?
If I say what's 2 + 2, there's an answer. It's 4.
7.
It doesn't matter if you wish that there was a million answers that were correct. There is an answer that's correct. And there's every other answer is wrong. There's an infinite amount of wrong answers to that question. But there is only one right answer.
Wow. I like that. Yeah. Let's get a little more context, because we've read 1 John 5:13 a lot by itself every week. We even started this week with it. So this is giving us some more context around
it.
But he goes on. What does he say?
I write these things that you who believe in the name of the Son of God, to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. And this is the confidence that we have toward him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the request that we have asked of him. If anyone sees his brother committing a sin, not leading to death, he shall ask and God will give him life. To those who commit sins that do not lead to death, there is sin that leads to death. I do not say that one should pray for that. Well, I hope not. Goodness. All wrongdoing is sin, but there is sin that does not lead to death.
This is kind of confusing,
This is a really confusing passage,
actually. There's a lot going on here. Last week, we talked about loving one another. And when I read this, I see that one way for me to love someone is like praying for them, right? When they're committing sins, not leading to death. Now, we found out that life is found in Christ. And if you don't have faith in Christ, then that leads to death. So is the sin that we're talking about the rejection of Jesus?
Yeah, if we say, what is it, that sin that leads to death? And I think that's the thing that makes sense.
There's only one, right?
That's what he's saying, that if you don't believe in Jesus, if you don't understand who he is, follow him, love him, you know, all of that stuff, then that's the sin that is, there's nothing you can do about that.
This is a spiritual death. This is the eternal separation from God instead of eternal life with Christ. And so here's a way to love each other according to this that I see is we pray for them, right? So like some of you have friends who are making a series of bad mistakes. Are you praying for them, or are you just like yelling at them and judging them?
Yeah.
Because there's power in prayer, it sounds like, according to what we read here in 1 John. Maybe you have a friend who's planning on going to that one party, you know, the one I'm talking about, high schoolers. Are you praying for that friend to make a better decision? And I love how John ends his letter, because he uses the word know, K-N-O-W, realize. He uses that several more times here. In fact, he gives us three no's as he wraps up 1 John 5. And I want to, there's a lot we can dig into this, and maybe you guys can do it in your small groups a little bit more. But for sake of time on the video, we're not going to get too much for it. But what's this first no?
We know that everyone who has been born of God does not keep on sinning, but he who was born of God protects him, and the evil one does not touch him.
Yeah, so this is interesting. If you've been born of God, you don't keep on sinning. Like that constant desire to sin.
Yeah, you could read that and think, well, if that means if I sin, I don't belong to God. I have to be perfect.
Right. No, but, it's right. That.
It's that keep on sinning. It's that active tense of saying, I'm going to sin and I don't care.
Right. So if you feel conviction, if you feel bad, that to me is evidence that Jesus is starting to change your heart a little bit. Right. So that if you have this desire, if you go back to week one, to stop walking in darkness, that tells me that Christ is changing your heart.
Right.
So when we know we're born of God, that desire starts to go away.
Right.
And that's part of that journey in our relationship with Jesus. Like the desire gets less and less as we know him more and more.
Right.
All right. Next, no.
We know that we are from God. Oh, excuse me. And the whole world lies in the power of the evil one.
This is interesting. Mm. So like you have for God and against God.
Right.
If you don't know God, if you are not one of his sons or daughters by faith in Jesus, then you are at odds with him.
Yeah, John is all about the binary, the black and white. It's either you're with God or you're out of God, or you're with God or with the world, or it's truth or lying, or it's light or dark.
Right.
He's very much about there's no middle ground. You're either with God or not.
Right. And it kind of, this is kind of hopeful, right? Because the brokenness of this world doesn't affect our stance with God.
Right.
Right. And so the Bible doesn't ignore the obvious brokenness and hurt that's in our world, but it also doesn't just like isolate it. Right. So like if I'm far from God and I'm rarely spending time with other believers, people who know Jesus and love him, the world start, that darkness just starts to like bring me down, right? It looks unwelcoming. I don't want anything to do with it. But when I'm a part of, this is why community is so important.
Definitely.
Right? When I'm a part of a group of believers and we all know that we are from God, verse 19, like we're in that community. And then there's this hopefulness of there's for God, which is me. And then there's the world, which is at odds with God. But because I'm with him, I don't have to fear that darkness. I don't have to fear that brokenness.
Right.
I can recognize it. I can embrace it, even knowing that God will redeem it all because I'm in him. All right. And the third no.
And we know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding so that we may know him who is true, and we are in him who is true, in his Son, Jesus Christ. He is the true God and eternal life. Little children, keep yourself from idols.
I love how he throws that in
there. And that's the last thing. That's the end of the whole book. That's the end.
So we know that Jesus has come to give us understanding so we can know him, right?
Yeah.
Like this gnosko, I think is the Greek word here.
Interesting.
Gnosko. And so this is like...
I think it's a silent G, gnosko.
No, it's G-I-N-O-S-K-O is how we write it.
But don't we get the idea of gnosko, like
gnosko? Gnosticism.
Gnosticism.
From it, yeah. That's interesting.
And gnosis.
Yeah, I'm wondering why there's an I in our
interesting
English transliteration of the Greek, right?
Because
we have...
Yeah, with... And this is like a whole other topic. We're not going to
geek out about Greek
into tonight, but like this, the very first heresy that really hit Christianity was called Gnosticism.
Yeah.
And there are threads and ideas of it that are still in the church today. If you ever want to know about that, talk to me in person.
So what's the 5 second, what is Gnosticism?
Ooh, the 5 second Gnosticism is the idea, it's about knowledge. It's it's that if you have like the secret knowledge, that is going to be what gets you closer to God. And it's this denial of the physical world in a pursuit of this allegedly holier spiritual side of reality that you achieve through knowledge.
Interesting. That was the 15-second version, but that was good. That was good. So I think what John wants us to realize here, right, is we can trust what the Bible says about Jesus in part because we actually have this knowledge of Jesus, right? He says, we know the Son of God has come and giving us understanding so we may know him to be true. So another way to look at this is the more history I build with Jesus, right? The more relationship I build with Jesus, the more I trust what he says, and I remember him in my daily life, right? So like, it's kind of like when you have that friend where you have a long history together, you kind of know them, even when they're not right there with you, you know what they're going to do. You know what they would want to do. You know what they would think about what you're doing type thing, because you have that deep relationship. And so the same is true with Jesus. I think through 1 John, like he wants all Christians to come to a point in their walk with Jesus where they realize that they have Jesus life flowing through us, like pulsing in our veins, if you want to get a little weird about it.
I love it. Pulsing in our veins.
Pulsing in
great mental image.
Our veins. So the encouragement to you is, and maybe I wrote down a few notes just based upon like these 4 weeks from John of the, if we see things with real eyes,
yeah,
we know that, or we realize,
okay,
there's eternal life in Jesus. If we ask, he forgives us.
Okay.
If we need help, he's our defense lawyer.
Love
it. And our payment. I think we mentioned that big word in week two, propitiation, right?
Propitiation. That is a big word.
Yeah. We realize that we should love because we are loved. Mm-hmm. And like we talked about last week, we realize that love isn't a feeling. It's more of a doing. It's that verb. And my love for others is evidence that God's changing me. I remember we talked about that last week.
That's great.
If we see it with real eyes, we know or realize that we should pray first, not last. I think that's kind of some of the stuff John was getting at. That prayer matters. I think a lot of times we try and coach and help and be a good friend just upon like with our own strength and accord, and like the prayer is the last resort.
Right. Prayer is kind of an afterthought.
Right. Prayer should be the first thing we do every time.
Yeah.
Jesus isn't just a hope. He's the only hope. Right, I think of Star Wars. Help me, Obi-Wan Kenobi. You're my only hope. Desperation. Jesus is literally the only hope.
I love it.
Anything else you're placing your hope in is going to fail. Fall short. And then like we can build this history with God, this long-term relationship where things continue to grow and develop when we recognize that we come from Him. This world's broken, but we don't have to be because we're made right in Him through Christ.
That's right.
Yeah. All right. You guys are gonna talk more about this. Maybe you can dive into some of these tougher sections of 1 John 5 together in your groups.
And next week, are we starting a new series?
Next week, we're going to start. This is the end of Real Eyes. Next week starts a new series.
Awesome. Yep. We'll see you then.